Dear friends, I, Neelam Manjunath, welcome you all to our Simple Talks 3 on Urban Lakes, Challenges and Opportunities from Center for Green Building Materials and Technology, School of Simple Living, Bangalore. Today we have Professor Architect Anand D.K. in conversation with Dr. Shobha Anand Reddy, an environmental scientist and activists on several environmental issues. I welcome you both. Professor Architect Anand D.K. is an advisory member of CGBMT. He is currently the professor design chair at School of College of Architecture, Trivandrum, a senior architect with a strong lineage to project management and development consulting. He graduated from Government College of Architecture, Lucknow in 1987 with me, and established a design partnership practice, in Lucknow. Later, he went on to work with large corporates like Sterling Resorts, Embassy Group, Shanferi, and is international in India and Middle East, including establishing a leading Nelson worldwide, a large US-based design practice in Delhi and Bangalore. He has steered several design and project teams, including hospitality, residential, commercial developments, and strategic planning projects, amongst others. Also, during his career, he has turned around contracting and construction operations with a profit and loss responsibility. An out-of-box thinker, stretching the team's abilities beyond limits is one of his traits, often keeping the group stay ahead. As a thorough professional, he sets examples for managing multiple projects and processes. He mentors a design studio doing international developments at Trivandrum, Kerala. Architect Anand is a fellow of the Indian Institute of Architects and a professional member of the Royal Institution of Chartered Surveyors, UK. He has served as an adjunct faculty at several schools of design. I welcome you, DK, once again. May I now request you to introduce our guest speaker, Dr. Shobha Anand.
Thank you, Neelam. It's always a great pleasure to be speaking with big experts. And I think when we think about Lake Anywhere and its revival and problems, we cannot forget and ignore a term, a name, Dr. Shobha. Dr. Shobha Anand Reddy is an environmental scientist by training and over 18 years of experience in teaching, research, practical training and advocacy. Her experience spans environmental and ecology, renewable energy, solid waste management, integrated water management and rural development. She is a student of citizen involvement and participatory governance for positive social and environmental transformation. She has served as a faculty at Mount Carmel College, Bangalore, also additional director environment, energy and biofuels at Mahatma Gandhi Institute of Rural Energy and Development, and also a research associate, Energy and Environment Group. Not to mention that she was also a senior consultant for the Urban Practitioners Program at Indian Institute of Human Settlements, Bangalore. She was instrumental in formation of a citizen group, Jal Mitra, the guardians of Rachanhalli Lake, which has been working with various stakeholders and actors for revival and maintenance of Rachanhalli Lake at Srirampura, Bangalore. She is a recipient of ICAL Award for Women Achievers 2020, instituted by Friends of Tribal Society and Environmental Scientists 2013, instituted by National Environmental Science Academy. She served as a member of Western Ghats Task Force Government of Karnataka. She is a NABET, NABET QCI accredited environmental consultant for carrying out environmental impact assessments in the development sector. She is a founding trustee of the Trust for Rejuvenation of Environment and Nature Development. We call it as TREND, through which since 2016, several initiatives such as providing solar home lighting to homes located in remote areas, providing education to the government school children, solid waste management, and environmental sustainability awareness programs under citizen science and education programs are being taken up regularly. That's Dr. Shobha. Let's talk to our main, get into our main discussion today. We often, when we see lakes, and when we have heard about lakes getting going away from the map, Bangalore seems to be a city which always props up. Way back in 1960, it was counted there were 280 lakes, often which was at the end of where the natural valley irrigation systems got formed and bundled out as terms of construction. There is also a literature in one of the essays which was presented in a paper by Indian Institute of Science that were close to 837 lakes way back in history. Incidentally, when we looked at 2007, this 280 lakes has come down to around 93. And during the survey, we realized that it only now upholds around only 918 hectares of the land. And 66% of them are sewage led. Not to mention that there are several percentage of them which are probably encroached, and very few of them revive, have got, stays as a good lake. And the effort of Dr. Shobha in reviving one of them and probably making several efforts on reviving others stands. So let's hear from her a good story about what's happening with these lakes. Bangalore has been expanding. We have been seeing it expanding every time. We always thought city is becoming big and city is being expanding its boundaries every time. But we never realized that while this boundary was being expanded and the extension was granted, we were also losing water bodies. So what is the condition of today's lakes and why is it like that? What do you think? Why? What is prompting this? We are losing the lakes every day. What is happening? Can you just give us a small outline of where we stand in respect to the lakes in the urban cities and urban areas?
Thank you, first of all, for a very elaborate introduction of mine. And let me admit, I'm not an expert. I'm learning with my whatever work I'm doing for the lake. And with what with the effort of working for Rajanali Lake, there has been a lot of learning that I have across. And my effort is only to try and take forward that learning so that others who may be interested in trying to do good to the society by way of engaging in revival of lakes may get some knowledge from me and then take it forward. So yeah, as you rightly put it across, lakes in Bangalore have vanished, not in small numbers of tens or twenties, but in numbers of hundreds. It used to be once called as a city of 1,000 lakes. Today is just left with about 100, 120 plus lakes. And you also mentioned that there are very few lakes which are in good condition and most of the lakes are filled with sewage, which is very true. And not just Bangalore, most of the cities are seeing the same situation. Even our rivers, we are seeing the same condition. So basically this lake, Rajanhalli, and its upstream lake, Jakkur, are two good lakes which seem to be in good condition in Bangalore in terms of its water quality. And I'm proud that I got the opportunity to be involved in the revival of this lake. And I'm also happy that a lot of citizens in and around the lake came forward and joined me in this effort. And we were collectively able to do a lot of work for this. So coming back to your question on what is happening to the lakes, I think you mentioned earlier about the irrigated systems and expansion of cities. I'd like to just go back a little bit and talk about how these lakes were formed and what was the original intention of use of these lakes and what is happening today with change in the landscape around the lakes. Most of the cities, the lakes that we see today are not originally formed, naturally formed or geologically formed lakes. They are all tanks built centuries ago with the purpose of storing rainwater to meet the water demand for the nearby communities for their agricultural and domestic uses. Over a period of time, because of rapid urbanization and industrialization, we see the very use of the lake itself has changed, the water bodies has changed. They no longer are used for drinking or even for agricultural activities. The agricultural lands around the water bodies have been converted into layouts, institutions, and a lot of development has taken place in and around. There's so much of road network that has come in. So as a result of which, it has also reduced the drainage capacity of the, or the catchment area has been totally changed for all these water bodies. It's also another point that we need to understand here is that all these lakes are connected with each other through stormwater drains. In other words, we call them as Raja Kaluves. So the overflowing water from one lake enters into the other lake, the downstream lake, through the stormwater drain. Over a period of time, because of urbanization and land pressure, we are seeing a lot of these stormwater drains have been encroached, and in many cases even the lake beds themselves have been encroached. We must also understand another fact that these lakes or the tanks would receive rainwater and they would be filled during the rainy season, and during non-rainy seasons the water body is exposed, and you know, there is the lake bed is basically exposed, and that's also another opportunity, that's an opportunity for land grabbers to encroach the land and then take it away for any other purpose. So as a result of which, we are seeing the connection between the lakes is lost basically, and a lot of water bodies are themselves missing in the cities, and the water bodies are also prone to lot of incoming sewage water and industrial effluents entering into the lakes because of absence of proper sewer network or the underground drainage systems in the cities. And we also don't have proper monitoring of regulations that exist. So ideally the sewage from the residential layout should be carried through a sewer network and should be taken to the STP and treated there, and then the treated water can be let into the stormwater drains or into the lakes. Likewise, industries are also supposed to have proper effluent treatment plants and then treat the water, but unfortunately the regulatory bodies such as pollution control boards are failing in ensuring that the STPs or the ETPs are properly functional and the water bodies are protected, which is not happening. So first threat is the water bodies are first of all facing existential threat because of land pressure on land. Second, water bodies of these lakes and the stormwater drains are getting continuously polluted. And third thing is because of this pollution, the biodiversity of the water body is totally lost. And fourth aspect is there is absolutely no accountability or ownership for any single agency is not owning the responsibility of anything that happens to the lake. So we basically have the water body, which is taken care by the municipal authority. And then you have the stormwater drain, which is taken care by another department. And then we have the sewer networks or the underground drainage systems, which are again is the responsibility of another agency in most of the cities, which is sewerage and water board. So because of this kind of non-collective efforts by different agencies, it is becoming very, very difficult for maintaining the lakes in a proper manner. And that's exactly why we see, a lot of lakes are under fire, foaming, and many other issues. Fish kill we see often in the lakes in cities. These are some of the problems that, this is actually the status of the lakes in cities, in most cities.
See, what I can definitely gather is that while the lake being a, I wouldn't say always a natural item, there are multiple agencies who are playing a role when it comes to things which are abutting the lake, whether it is the effluents or whether it is the water, whether it is encroachers, whether it is water bodies, whether it is road network or something other, multiple things. So ultimately the ownership, though belongs to the government or coming, has been handed over to the maintenance bodies, they are probably not taking a complete absolute responsibility to do it. So which definitely the affected party is the neighborhood. So I guess your game plan to engage them is the key word to get them onto its right path. So if I can understand right, I mean, definitely you have revived a lake and you have written stories about and put up a structure of how to revive it. So let us understand your story of this Rachanahalli lake, which you have revived in the last few years, and it is slowly getting back to a norm where it has probably become a pride of that area. Let's understand that from you a little more.
So as you rightly said, multiple stakeholders, multiple agencies, and then the ultimate system that gets impacted is the neighborhood. And that's exactly has been the motto of the citizen groups working in Bangalore, because if we are impacted, then we have to act. Nobody else is going to come and save it for us. Citizens have to start taking ownership, mainly because if you look at government agencies that I was talking about, the municipalities which are in charge of the lakes or the government bodies that are in charge of the lakes, they're already understaffed. And that's one thing that all of us must realize, all of us know, and all of us are very clear that in the entire country, most of the government departments are understaffed and working at 50% strength. It's the same thing that applies here also. In Bangalore, when I started working for Rachanahalli Lake, I realized that BBMP, which is BBMP Lakes Division, which is responsible for maintenance of lakes in Bangalore, had about 80 plus lakes under their list of lakes to be maintained. And they were just about 4 or 5 staff members. And that is where, most of us citizen groups working for the lakes try to empathize with the government departments. And instead of questioning them or criticizing them, we felt we can play a collaborative role and try and join them and work with them. So just like anybody else, we also started off with trying to be a citizen pressure group, and we tried to raise, some petitions around the lake for inlet of effluents into the lake. So we initially gathered about, 5,000 signature campaign we did and tried to submit it to the government to stop sewage entry into the lake. So that is how we thought that we would act as a citizen pressure group, and then gradually the government will come in, step in, and they will do maintenance of the lake and they will take it forward is what we thought, but that did not work. So then eventually what we came up with as a strategy was, in Bangalore we were lucky because already there was a system of formal system of entering into MOUs with the citizen groups for maintenance of the lakes, thanks to Mrs. Usha Rajagopalan and her team, and also Mr. Satish, who happened to serve as chief engineer Lakes Division for a long time, almost for 10 years. So as early as 2009-10 itself, they had evolved a mechanism for entering into an MOU with the citizen group for maintenance of the lake. So this requires a formally registered society or a trust or an organization, which is a citizen group, which can give a letter to the government and say that we want to maintain this lake. And then BBMP will come forward and enter into an MOU with the citizen group. And that's how the whole program of maintaining the lake can be taken forward. So there were also several other models that existed in Bangalore, like Friends of Lakes model, which did not believe in formally engaging in the maintenance of the lake, but in a way try and enthuse more citizens in and around to be active participants in the protection of the lake. So that, whenever there are things going bad with the lake, they could still act as citizen pressure group at that point of time, or motivating the citizens to be engaged in coming to the lake and spending their time at the lake and cleaning up the lake, these kind of activities. So we decided that we will go with the formal trust model because that was very much needed for this lake. And I also learned that this lake was already developed by 2010. Where government had spent more than 16 crore rupees and totally revived the lake at that point of time. But because of lack of maintenance, in just a matter of 3 years, it had gone to a state of disuse and it was totally in bad shape. The fence was ripped apart, bund area was filled with lot of weeds, and a lot of open defecation was happening in and around the lake. So basically at that point of time, I was working for a government institution, and so initially it was an official obligation for me to start working for the lake. So we tried initially to give a call to people in and around the area where my colleagues from the institute, we brought out a lot of pamphlets, newspaper inserts, and we distributed more than 5,000 newspaper inserts at that point of time. And one of my colleagues took lead in trying to work with nearby schools to take them on a rally, and then, you know, to create awareness among people, saying that we as an institution are trying to take up initiative to revive the lake. Now we give you a call because it has to be a citizen-led activity and we want you to be actively involved. So it was a massive two-day marathon and rallies, everything was held, and 5,000 newspaper inserts distributed. But to our bad luck, we had just about 3 or 4 people who came and participated from the neighborhood area. And those 3 people were also people who were working with us, with my institute, for various other things. So that was a great disappointment for me, that when there is somebody saying we will take the initiative to protect the lake in your area, you come and join, there was no response from people. And we tried to hold it on a Saturday itself. But we had also decided to invite some nearby school and college to symbolically commence the lake revival process. So we had also invited the government officials and another citizen group, which is the upstream lake of Rajanahalli Lake, which is called as Jakkur Lake, where a citizen group by name Jalaposhan was already actively working for the revival of the lake. So the story of Jalaposhan was told in this particular platform. And the 3-4 people who came in there, and then I was also impressed by that. And then I felt we should now take forward that model for Rajanahalli Lake also. That's where we took the decision of that. And the next 2 years' time, we tried to spend our personal time, most of us, Saturdays, Sundays, we used to spend time at the lake. Evenings, mornings, whenever we could get time, we started spending time at the lake to invite more local people to come. So initially, the first few of us were trying to pick up the garbage, and then eventually it was like, you know, we were basically looking like paurakarmikas trying to pick the garbage at the lake. We pick and then we put it across, hand it over to BBMP, and the very next day there's somebody else who's coming and dumping. So that was a continuous thing that was happening, and we felt demoralized. And where is it heading? And a lot of citizens who came in the initial phase started getting demoralized, that, I mean, we are just doing this and nothing, no progress is happening to the lake. So that's when I tried to understand the actual ownership of the lake and everything else. And we realized that the lake belonged to another agency, the development agency, which had taken it up for development. And then it was supposed to be handed over to the municipality for taking care of the lake. So both, there was an issue of maintenance, and therefore both, neither of them were looking after the maintenance of the lake. And that's when we started trying to pull in money from our own pockets, and we started clearing small stretches. We hired JCBs and all those kind of activities. We started to clear the bund area. The local administration at that point of time, joint commissioner, I approached him, and he gave us support of about 10 gangmen who came and cleared 100 meter stretch in one day. And then after it was cleared, with one rain, I started seeing a lot of weeds coming there. And by then the citizen group had sort of become mellowed down. They were not having the interest to come and participate. So then I didn't want to get deterred. I started spending my weekends at the lake every Saturday, Sundays morning, 1 hour I started spending. And then many passers-by would come and ask me, what are you doing at the lake and things like that. And I told them that this is the effort and we had started, and it has unfortunately got abandoned, but I don't want to leave it. If any of you are interested, please join. So gradually that weekend spending helped me get another 7 to 8 more active people who also started coming and joining me in the cleaning up process. So that's how we then formed our own WhatsApp group, where we started exchanging information about why we need to protect the lake, what is happening to the lake, and what is the long-term benefits of the lake and its biodiversity, and the impact of having good lake in that particular neighborhood for the people around the place. All these things we started sharing and exchanging, and we started organizing small events on, you know, days like World Environment Day, Earth Day. We made use of all those days as important opportunities for us to create more awareness among people from the neighborhood. So initially it was all our own friends or our own apartment people whom we started inviting, and gradually the message started spreading that we were actively working for the lake. And then by 2016, we had almost managed to keep the lake, to bring back the lake about 200 meter stretch to a good condition, because the institute that I was working in also sent the students that we had, some residential program we were running there called a Surya Mitra program. We made it mandatory for the students to spend their mornings at the lake for walk and cleaning and maintaining. That helped us clean and revive the lake. And also we gave out a call to about 30-40 schools which were located within 2 kilometer radius of the lake area. And then at that point of time, there was one faculty by name Bindu from a school called as Legacy School who came forward, and then she joined us as a volunteer also, as well as she started bringing her students on a regular basis for the work at lake. So that eventually helped us to maintain another 100 meter stretch. 100 meters as citizens we had maintained, 100 meters the institute where I was working had revived, another 100 meters this school which came forward started maintaining. So like that, the entire lake periphery is about 3.3 kilometers. Small stretches we started targeting to clear up and then maintain small stretches. So then BBMP told us that you have to have a formal registered body for us to now enter into an MOU with you. So that is when by 2016 we formed a formal trust by name Jalmitra. Some eight to nine of us, most of them living around the lake, came together, and I was fortunate to get that team, that entire team of members, which had a solid waste management expert, and we had a retired Army Major General who passionately drove the entire effort thereafter, and a bird watcher we had in the group, and many others. A school teacher was also there in the group, and some IT staff were also there. So this group, we started trying to focus more on trying to put enough pressure on the government to complete the pending work that was. And then we realized it's not possible for us as citizen group to talk with government agencies. So that's when we tried to take the help of our elected representative, MLA, the MLA of our constituency, Mr. Krishna Bairagoda. He stepped in, he helped us by talking to the authorities to complete whatever pending work was there for the lake, which included clearing of jungle in some portions of the area, and the outlets of the lake were in bad shape. So he supported in trying to get that work done. And also some bund area was in a bad condition. So he helped us in getting that done. So that eventually helped in ensuring that anyone who gets into the lake could take a complete walk around the lake. So till then it was not possible, but with the interventions of MLA that was possible. Thereafter gradually we started organizing more events and started working, and we also entered into a tripartite agreement at that point of time with the BBMP, ourselves as citizen group, because we wanted to remain apolitical and we did not want to involve in any financial activities. So there was another third agency called as United Way for Bengaluru, which also entered into this tripartite arrangement. The role of UWBE was to raise CSR funds. So at this point of time, this agency was able to bring in money from the first set of funds came in from Kargil. Under CSR, they provided some money, which helped us in trying to hire laborers, gardeners for the area. And gradually we started working also with the fishing community, which was there at the lake. So government had already given contract of fishing in that particular area. So to a great fishermen also serve as first level of defense at the lake. So any sewage entry kills fish, and then it's not okay for them. Therefore, they also started working with us, and that's how we started trying to work towards revival of the lake. And the lake, which was not even being, nobody was even stepping into the lake in the year 2014, as I have seen. Today, if you go on any weekday, you can easily count more than 1,000 people coming for a walk, jog, and enjoying the serenity at the lake. So that's how our entire journey of revival of lake was taken up.
Just heard the entire story of the revival of the lake and how it has translated from a one man per army to three, and then expanded off with a drop off and then coming back. I think the single passion and perseverance of a warrior is visible to make that happen. That is definitely true. That is why we can see, and today we can walk around the lake of that entire selfless efforts that you took. One thing which I often wonder is that how do you ensure that the neighborhood gets engaged on one side, and on the other side you have got a fund-starved government agency? So how do you make sure that the funding is available, and resources are completely available to make this happen, apart from your selfless service of your weekends and many others who do that. But to make it a complete exercise, we need both these things to gel. How did you achieve it in this case?
So in this case, I think it was more of, as I outlined earlier, it was a journey of starting as citizen pressure group to becoming collaborators with the government to work for revival of the lake by way of entering into MOU with them. So first of all, I think the biggest challenge is there has to be someone who will take the lead. It's the same in all conservation groups or lake groups that you see. We have about 40 plus lake groups in Bangalore. All of them are led by one single person who starts off, and then, you know, there are many others who join them, and then the group gets strengthened eventually, and then, you know, you have a nice group which is working collectively for protection of the lake. So I think creating that kind of awareness among citizens is very important. That role is already being played by many in Bangalore, like Mr. Vishwanath Zen Rainman. He's been doing tremendous efforts to try and write a lot about it and try to create that awareness among people. And success stories are being continuously shared in Bangalore. And so one success story becomes, a starting point for many other cases. Right. Like Jal Poshan was the success story for me to take it forward. Right. And a lot of people wrote about me in papers and Better India and Logical Indian. And after that, many people have been approaching me. Even today, there was somebody who texted me saying, you know, we want your help to form a citizen group for so-and-so lake. So like that, the lesson of what we have learned with one lake revival effort has to go forward. And that's exactly what we're doing. So for this particular lake, as I said earlier, initially, it was more of, you know, I would like to categorize citizen engagement for any conservation effort at three levels. Level one is, which is more like a sporadic kind of an event where people can get involved by way of protesting or criticizing about it or trying to report to government or whatever it is, which we do because it's like a spontaneous thing. I'm walking through this place or my house is here and then I'm seeing somebody dumping the garbage there. I get annoyed and then I report it or I try to criticize that. I write it on Facebook or whatever that I want to do, I will do. Second thing is continuously, this is my path. This is the road I'm going. And then there is sewage entering into this lake through something. And then that wastewater is obstructing my path and it's filthy smell. Therefore, I get agitated and then I want to be, engaging in some way or the other. So even those kind of events are, some people may just go on change.org and then file a petition about it or try and raise voice about it in the media, or they could even just write about it in the WhatsApp groups of their civil society group, residential welfare association or whatever. So that is the first level of engagement that citizens are engaging in. And that's exactly what happened in our case also. There were fish kill at one point of time. So some people raised voice at that point of time. And then there was also a lot of honeysuckers coming and dumping the fecal sludge into the lake. All these kind of events were happening. And we also tried to protest initially by trying to submit a petition. Signature signed petitions to the Pollution Control Board saying you please stop entry of sewage into the lake and things like that. And then that was not enough for actual revival of the lake. Then the next level starts where, I would call it as getting into the mode of supportive role, which is more of little more engagement than just being one time engaging, where we can start volunteering and then we can start actually doing something to protect the water body, which can be by creating awareness among people or by way of physically being there and then cleaning up the area, which should not just get limited to one-time event, but then a continuous kind of an event. Even that was not sufficient in our case. And then that is when we moved to the third level of engagement, which I call as collaborative role, which involved direct engagement with the government and trying to talk to two, three various departments on behalf of one government department, which is actually the owner of the lake. So we all know in government, people don't see each other. They don't even come for meetings and then interact with each other. They all talk on by way of files. And so that actually becomes a roadblock for many good things. Even if the officials are well-intended, well-meaning, these procedural delays also cause a lot of harm. And another thing is understaffed. Because they are understaffed, it's a serious problem for them. So that is where we felt getting engaged in a collaborative role was much better. And that's how we started working with the government. So funding, yes, funding is another issue. I think all of us must understand why funding is required for lakes. So there are two things when it comes to lake revival process and then funding. One is, when you see a water body, it can be in a very bad shape. It might have been a lake which was recently revived and then it has gone to a state of disuse, or it might be a lake which has been recently revived. So if it's a lake which has been recently revived, then the funding that is required for that lake is only the maintenance cost, per year maintenance cost, which may amount to about 15 to 25 lakh rupees. If it's a lake where nothing has been done, from beginning it is just like that. So that is where maybe some excess amount of funds may be required for actual rejuvenation process, which will involve fencing the lake to ensure that it is protected from any encroachments. And maybe if at all the silt level is too much, then desilting for the lake and partial bunding. And we don't advocate complete bunding of the lake, partial bunding so that some walking can happen. But nowadays, of course, the existing model of development is complete bunding all around the lake, and that's how it's happening. Yeah. And maybe some other small infrastructure things like minimal amount of lighting at the lake, and you know, one bench for the lake, or maybe somebody wants to have a gazebo. The group may want to have a gazebo to create educational programs, to conduct educational programs at the lake. That's the minimal. That's the kind of money that may be required for initial rejuvenation process. So largely this kind of funds can come from government itself. So ideally it takes a year for government to get this budget allotted. So if we report to the government that this lake is in a bad shape and we as citizen groups want to take care of this lake and maintain the lake, then we can talk to the government and tell them that we are interested in reviving it. And that's what we did also. And it took about 1.5 years for government to get that allotment of money done for that particular lake from government funds itself under various schemes. Governments have different schemes through which they can allot money for lake revival. That 1 year period definitely it takes if government has to revive it. And that may amount anywhere between 8 crores to 20 crores or 25 crores, depending on the size of the lake and the kind of, the need of the lake with respect to what kind of development has to be done at the lake. And then the maintenance, as I said earlier, is hardly 15 to 20 lakhs, which is meant basically for maintaining the garden in the area, water supply, electricity supply to the water body, and maybe home guards for security, which is actually given by the government itself. So their salaries have to be met. And any educational programs or any awareness programs that we want to have at the lake, we may need. Or any other interventions like putting up trash barriers to ensure that solid waste doesn't get into the lake, or those kind of things can be taken up under maintenance funds. So, as I said earlier, it is always better to let government do the revival process. Of course, many of us don't agree with the government method of revival, because it is not going in the right way of revival of lake for ecosystem services point of view. It is going more from the point of view of putting in more infrastructure into the lake and destroying the lake ecosystem. That's another aspect that one has to look into. But whatever said and done, the actual rejuvenation revival process, it is better if it is done by the government itself. So there are also cases where many corporates have come forward saying they want to pull in money under their corporate social responsibility, because some of them do have their CSR policies cover issues like lake rejuvenation itself has become a big CSR theme now in many companies. So within their impact zone basically is, if the company is located, their headquarters is here, then within some 2-3 kilometers or 5 kilometer radius, they may want to invest. So that is one model of trying to raise money, which again the companies will enter into an MOU with the government and then they will execute the project. Then for maintenance is again another thing where money is required, which can 90% of the times governments don't allot money for maintenance. All infrastructure projects we have seen, nowhere governments consider maintenance as a budget and they don't even allot the money for it. So that is where the drawback is, and that's where we as citizen groups come in. And then we have also raised money initially from people. All of us have pulled into the group and we have tried to create some events at the lake. All those things we have done. all groups are also doing the same thing. So that is also another place where CSR money comes in for maintenance of the lakes. So it is possible for any citizen group to approach companies to provide money for maintenance of the lakes.
We touched two aspects. One was on the process where a denial stage of the lake remains, and then it becomes a collaborative part of the society. I mean, that's a stage where you explained about the three levels and how the engagement grew from a driven format, somebody can do anything, to no, I want to be part of that, and then everybody driving to make sure that it's happening right for the game. CSR is definitely a good move, but now I have a question in this, that while you can suggest, and since you've gone through the entire life cycle of rejuvenation of a lake, you have seen through the limitations and the opportunities that exist, while on the way the lake has got transformed on one side, and on the other side, the red tapeism or not availability of funding and several departments and stuff like that, how do you ensure, and that's the second part, and the third part is when you involve a corporate company to participate in the CSR, obviously they will come and interfere in some kind of a development program and probably do something else which may not necessarily be the right way to do it and ensure its longevity of the exercise that is being done. Because as you rightly said, the custodian of the lake is the government. Government may have limitations to get certain things done, whether it is a resource or whether it is funding and things. But warriors and champions like you ensure the trust being formed, the engagement team getting in place, the citizens chapter or citizens group getting active. And then you have the third party who come in with the funding format. So how do you balance that? So my question to you now is to understand, what do you suggest on a typical lake revival rejuvenation model, and how do you ensure that it's on the right side of things and it is benefiting the entire neighborhood and the right biodiversity?
It's a very big challenge, and I must admit that I have failed, or our group has failed, with respect to Rajaneli Lake, because our whole objective right from beginning was to maintain a very nice ecosystem around the lake and protect the lake ecosystem in a good manner. So the lake already had a wetland, constructed wetland, which was purifying the wastewater and then entering into the lake. There were design issues with respect to the wetland, because of which the wetland was not functional throughout the year. So that was one issue. And yes, you rightly said, corporate under CSR, when they come in, there is a lot of interference. And there is always this demand for meeting their requirements or meeting their commitments, and which becomes priority. And then there is always scope for citizen group to be sidelined in this entire process. And I must admit, it did happen with us, with our lake, but still we have not given up. We are consistently trying to fight back. So ultimately, to resist this kind of interference from third party or this kind of corporate funding agency, is the civic group that is working for the lake should be strong and should be driven by the common goal of, with what vision you had for the lake right in the beginning, stick to that vision and try and ensure that you protect it. Achieving the ways may be different. Like, for example, if I want to protect the lake for ecosystem services point of view, minor differences, variations can happen, but then ultimate goal cannot change. So in our case, what happened was there was a yoga platform, children play area that came in, and even before we started working for the lake itself, a portion of the lake area had got converted into park area using the water body area itself. So, I mean, we are also seeing a lot of these development models of lakes, which are, people also don't understand, nearby people, they always want a concrete path on the lake. They don't understand that concrete bund is not good for the lake ecosystem. One is, you know, it absorbs, it gives absorbs a lot of heat, and also it doesn't help in rainwater infiltration. Right. So the soil layer or the murram layer of the bund area is one nice way of trying to, you know, that's one of the ecological ways of trying to protect the lakes. Likewise, the planting around the lake, we cannot go for ornamental plants and lawn and these kind of things. Unfortunately, whenever we have these corporate agencies, their focus is more on exotic species and going in for ornamental varieties and lawn, and that is where there has been a constant, you know, fight between the citizen group and the government authorities also, because even government authorities don't involve much in these things. The ideal way of doing it is the funding agency should come in, citizen group should be called in, and even the government, the custodian should sit together and then chalk out a proper plan for the lake. There will be some disagreements, some agreements, but some agreement has to be made with respect to what, how are we going to revive the lake and take that forward. So instead of that, unfortunately, in many cases, even in our case, the citizen group was not actively involved in the decision-making process, as a result of which even the BBMP horticulture itself has come up with a lot of ornamental planting around the lake, which has been severely criticized by people. And but there is a very small section of people who don't agree with it. Majority of people do believe in that kind of development because they think it is aesthetic looking and it's very nice to walk around in such area. Naturally, if you maintain the bund area, then there will be snakes and, you know, insects which they don't want to see. So that's also another big conflict within the citizen group. I can say that because very few citizens are really educated about this and want to understand that ecological methods of revival is important than going by, aesthetic kind of development for the lake. So that's a big challenge when it comes to, you know, this kind of resisting the influence from external agencies. So if the citizen group is collectively working together and if they're all committed to the same cause, then it is possible to fight it back.
Probably one of the models may be that the government, being a custodian of this entire exercise, may have a charter of some things which should not be done, and it's a balance between the CSR drivers' demands and probably a balance between what should be rightfully done and agree on certain things, and that can be. I don't know when will be that time. Probably when you, as the change agents, are coming in, putting everything in place with the long vision of really transforming everything, which is for everybody's good. But there we have got, ultimately we need funds. So CSR guy is coming in. So he may have a lot of intentions. So maybe we should draw through the custodian to draw, these are the things definitely we cannot do. And an expert committee in that thing probably draws that line and gives you that additional weapon to work on to make sure that you're always engaged. So then probably it could be a win-win situation, is what I think. So yeah, I think
it requires policy change required at that level for ensuring that proper guidelines for rejuvenation of lake are drawn.
Correct.
And that's important. So, another point that I want to add here with respect to rejuvenation of lakes is most of the lakes are rejuvenated with stone pitching done at the slope, which actually destroys the shore biodiversity, and that's very bad for the system. That is another aspect which most of us are trying to fight back with the system.
Okay, yeah, thank you.
Good. Thank
you.
It was very nice to hear the entire storyboard, from seeing a lake which is non-existent, which may have become where you don't see anything, and changing its time to become a lake where it allows flora and fauna and us to participate and become a part of that entire nature's thing. That's a very nice story that we heard, and especially the engagements. Yeah. Yes, Neeram.
Yeah, so thanks, Roba. That was a really very inspiring story of the lake rejuvenation. And I'm in a very small part of it, probably the beginner in 2008 through one of the programs that we did, Walk for Water, for this Rajchand Nadi Lake and Amrit Hadi Lake. But I think you've already carried, your persistence has already carried it through. And, you know, I mean, I really appreciate, I mean, your effort. One small, you know, in the last, just the last point that you were touching is like, do you think that the model that we have developed, and you said that in some aspects probably did not work, but can we, can it be developed as a model for lake revival and taken to the policy level as to whatever the lacunas are there? And I think recently we have got another authority. Earlier it was Lake Development Authority. Now it has become Tank and Lake Development Authority in Bangalore. And the Chief Secretary himself has been chairing the meeting. I do not know how. I attended a few of the meetings. And I think I already discussed with you also one of the lakes around our you know, place where we are there located. We wanted to take it up with your help. So if we can take it to the policy level, it can become a model for other towns and cities in our country, and that will be really a great thing. So do you think we can actually develop, and how do we do that?
I mean, I've already started making an effort to trying to write a lake rejuvenation guidebook, which I'm working on for the last 5-6 months. So, I mean, I have a drawback of, you know, not coming from a design background. Therefore, I'm looking for some design experts to help me to start looking at, you know, drawing those kind of nice, because I think the text also has to be accompanied by some sketches and designs. So that work is already ongoing, and not only me, even two other people, you must be aware of Friends of Lakes, Nageshwar and Ram, have also been working on coming up with some such thing where, you know, they can prepare a guideline for CSR implementers. So whenever CSR funding comes in for lakes, what is the kind of development that has to happen? They're already working on it. At my individual level, because I have seen that this is what I wanted to do, I wanted to do, not because that's my ego or because of my single determination, more from the point of view of ecology and environment of the lake, and for the good health of the people around the lake is what we were trying to develop a nice model. Definitely, I'll be more than happy to, you know, get support from anybody and take it forward further, because also another wrong approach that most of the governments are doing, not only in Bangalore, in all cities, is single lake approach. Just reviving one single lake is not enough. We must keep in mind that the entire series, if I'm reviving the lake here, what if the lake upstream is getting polluted, or the lake another level above that is getting polluted? Then whatever efforts I've made for this is gone waste. So it's very important to make sure that lake series approach is considered when it comes to revival of the lakes. And also some efforts for catchment area protection have to be considered. So none of the lake revival or great rejuvenation models that we are seeing go beyond the lake area. They just talk about, you know, bunding the area, fencing the area, and desilting and making an island there, and then some developing nice beautification around the lake. That's all. But we have to start looking beyond just that one lake, consider the entire series, also look at the catchment, also look at the stormwater drains, inlets, outlets, everything. So that is the ideal way of rejuvenation of lakes. That is something I'll be more than happy to, you know, work with you to take it forward further.
Yeah, we will be most happy. We'll be most happy. And we have Dr. Yellappa Reddy on board with us. So I think he can really guide us as to, with his vast knowledge of this. And we can definitely do the graphics work as you were telling about, so that we can talk separately on that. The whole thing now comes down, as I see from what I gather from all the talks that we have, simple talks today, the citizen could be the only driver of change. And that brings the whole focus of all development probably which we need to do in a situation like COVID, or in any calamity that we are facing today. As you, I mean, your was one example of a lake, like in one ecosystem. But similarly, there are several ecosystems which actually make the whole, you know, the picture. So citizen is always at the center of that particular universe, and generally people think that what can I do? I am alone and other people will not listen. But you have proved that, you know, and through your talk that we can see it actually works. So somebody has to begin. As you said, all of them are single person led initiatives, and then people join later. That was one part. There's another part which actually I have been talking about in various forums, and even in architecture forum or any other government forums also, is about I'm situated here in one part of the Bangalore, and we have different kind of people and of different our expertise in one area. So if we are able to have this 5 kilometer radius kind of a groups, or 6 kilometers or 10 kilometers, like blocks, or let's say blocks, and these, they take care of their own backyard, you know, the lakes around. In fact, the program that we did in 2008 was based on that, because I was shifting to this area in 2008. And I thought, okay, if I can clear the 5 lakes which are around me, that was Rajchenhali Lake, and then we had this Amritsarhali Lake, Venkatpura Lake, Jakkur Lake, and there was one more nearby. I'm just forgetting it towards this behind side. I'm just forgetting the name of the lake. If we are able to... So if we are able to do that, and if every person in a city does that, is a group formed, then you don't really need, and that goes from lakes to any other thing, all kinds of developments and things like that. So this could work. Do you think, since you have dealt with the government departments and other people, and also the political people or political representative of the area, do you think that's a possible solution that can be taken up or something?
I personally feel there is nothing that's impossible. I think all of us have to commence with the thought that it is possible and we can do it. And basically, it probably requires a blueprint or a small proposal or, some determined effort to come in. I think in this direction, I just want to let you know, one thing is that, I've always believed that cities are expanding, and all of us are seeing how badly the city is expanding. One, it's the right time for us to start looking back and then try and do the city master plans the way they are done. It's randomly done, and there's more emphasis given to the development and less emphasis to the green spaces and blue spaces. So we have lost enough. So it's high time in master plans we put enough pressure on government to ensure that they freeze whatever blue spaces and green spaces are there now, and do the development in the other land that is there. This is the crucial thing that one has to look into. I think many people now believe in this concept, and everybody wants to get into conservation efforts. And definitely this approach can be taken forward. And it requires some amount of, convincing people. And then, we can't be extreme in our thoughts, because the minute we become, this is exactly what we want, then there's a lot of resistance. So maybe trying to find some middle path where we can try and bring everybody on board and have some brainstorming session and then work with them, it may work. But another big problem in our systems is offices keep changing. And what we propose to one officer, he may approve it, and the minute the officer changes, another officer comes, it may not be taken up very positively by him. So that is where elected representatives can play a key role. And now you're also aware that we have the ward committees. So we must probably also try and work with the local administration, the municipality and the corporator. So they have to also be on board. And then I think it is possible to achieve what you're trying to say.
So basically what we are talking about, this decentralization of the development process is, yes, I think, and a community-based approach. I think that's the key to, so we have to take ownership of our surroundings. The moment we start, a community starts doing that, I mean, starting from the house. I think you've already, I had a last question. Generally, I put is like, as a single person, what you can do. But I think the whole talk was about us, what a single person can do, and really what an achievement. I think that's up to you. So we are really thankful that you were able to join and give your good time. And I'm very sure that our viewers will be able to benefit. And we will see many, many more lakes I think rejuvenated across the country. We, with that hope, big hope, I think, but not unachievable, as you said. I thank everyone for this interview.
Thank you so much, DK,
for conducting it. And thank you so much.
Thank you,
viewers, for watching it for us. And I think I will get back to us with any feedback, and we will be able to connect even Dr. Shobha with you in case you need any kind of guidance or anything for further work in this area. Thank you.